What's the most common substance in the human body? Water, of course. That's every kid's go-to science fact. Well, what is the most common substance in the world? Not water, because yeah, if you look at a map, 70% of it is covered in water, but our planet is not flat. It goes down. And remarkably, the most abundant stuff in the world is a mineral that is exceptionally rare on the surface. In fact, it is so rare, scientists didn't even have a name for it until 2014. And it is part of a larger group of minerals called perovskites that have some pretty incredible properties, including possibly unlocking the next generation of green energy. If you could dig down 660 kilometers beneath the Earth's surface, you would hit a layer of hot, dense rock called the lower mantle. And this is where the most common mineral calls home. Of course, we would never succeed in drilling down to anywhere near the upper mantle, let alone the lower mantle, so we can't just grab a sample of that hot, dense rock to figure out exactly what minerals are down there. But scientists can and do conduct lab experiments where they put rocks under the extreme heat and pressure that you would find in the deep. And it's from these experiments that we've learned the most abundant mineral in the lower mantle has a structure with this chemical formula. Each crystal of this stuff is made of repeating units of one magnesium atom, one silicon atom, and three oxygen atoms over and over. As for what this mineral is called, well, turns out mineralogists are a bit weird when it comes to naming things. They have a rule where in order to give a mineral an official name, you must be able to study and describe a sample that comes from nature, making it in a lab isn't good enough. And this mineral just doesn't like to exist at the temperatures and pressures that you find outside of the lower mantle. The crystal structure can break down over time, turning it into a different mineral made up of the same ingredients. So while scientists can occasionally stumble upon a mantle rock that's made it to the Earth's surface, say by coming up through a volcano or from a tectonic plate shifting around, the mineral you can hold in your hand is often not the one you're actually looking for. But after decades of searching, scientists finally struck not literal gold in 2014 when one team tried looking at rocks that came not from the Earth, but from outer space. That's right, they carefully studied the minerals in a meteorite. Because when this space rock crashed into the planet's surface, it momentarily experienced around 24 gigapascals of pressure and got heated up to around 2300 Kelvin. In other words, conditions that match what you would find in the Earth's lower mantle. And upon extremely close examination, the team found a tiny grain of the mineral they were looking for. With a naturally occurring sample in hand, the thing that makes up 38% of our planet's volume and the most common mineral in the world could finally get a name. Bridgmanite. But here's another weird naming thing mineralogists do. Sometimes they'll group a bunch of different minerals under one umbrella term, not based on the elements they're made of, but the ratio between the different elements they're made of. Since bridgmanite crystals are made from repeating units of one magnesium, one silicon, and three oxygen atoms, that makes it belong to a greater group of minerals called perovskites. Not because it's made of magnesium, silicon, and oxygen, but because it fits into this generic formula, ABX3, where A and B are positively charged ions and the X's are negative. That is what all perovskites have in common.
This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant, the online learning platform with thousands of lessons in computer science, math, and science. With Brilliant, you can learn everything from programming to data analysis from the best of the best. Experts from Caltech, Duke, and MIT can help you master those concepts without having to sit through classes at those institutions. Because, let's face it, we all know learning comes easier when you have a hands-on approach compared to falling asleep in a lecture hall. Instead of memorizing stuff to pass a test, you can build critical thinking skills through problem solving. I'm talking puzzles, case studies, and all sorts of learning tools that you get to play with in any given Brilliant lesson. And you can get started at brilliant.org/scishow or at the link in the description. That link will also give you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription and 30 days for free.
The first perovskite mineral, which you can actually just call plain old perovskite, was discovered in Russia back in 1839. To distinguish it from all the other perovskites, you would also see it called calcium titanate, because its crystal unit is one calcium, one titanium, and three oxygen atoms. But nearly two centuries later, scientists have found a ton of different element combinations that you can slot into this pattern. In fact, of all of the metallic elements on the periodic table, you can use over 90% of them in a perovskite mineral. And I do mean you. use. Some perovskites are found in nature, and some are made in a lab. And those lab-grown perovskites have some pretty tantalizing applications. Since 2009, scientists have been very interested in how halide metal perovskites, meaning those three X atoms are a halogen like fluorine or chlorine, could be used to revolutionize our solar panel technology. Today, the light-collecting cells in most solar panels are made with silicon-based crystals. They work pretty well, but they could be hard to manufacture. The silicon crystals themselves need to be practically flawless, with almost no impurities for them to do their job efficiently. So they have to be heated up to like 900 degrees Celsius to make sure there aren't too many defects. Meanwhile, perovskite crystals can perform just as well as silicon ones with many more imperfections. And to process them, you only have to heat them up to like 100 degrees, making perovskite solar panels not just cheaper to manufacture, but more environmentally friendly because you don't need as much energy. There's also the fact that you can create different perovskites, each with its own preference for the kind of light it likes to gobble up, and you can combine them to maximize how much sunlight you are converting into electricity. It's all very exciting. I spend a lot of time reading about perovskites. So, why haven't we all switched to perovskite solar panels? Well, there are a few catches. Durability is the biggest one. These synthetic perovskites have a tendency to decompose when they are exposed to moisture or oxygen or light. Those are all things that happen to solar panels. So early versions of perovskite panels lasted for mere minutes. And thanks to a decade plus of research, today's can last for months. But that's not good enough to compete with silicon, whose solar panels can last for decades. Another major issue is the fact that the best metal we've found to slot into that generic perovskite crystal structure is lead, which is rather famous for being nasty to both people and the environment if you're not very careful with it. But despite these hurdles, research into perovskite solar panels is moving very fast. In 2009, they had an efficiency of 3%, meaning they could only convert 3% of the solar energy shining down on them into usable electricity, and today it's over 25%, which rivals the best silicon solar panels. Researchers are also working to develop better seals that can keep moisture out, keep any lead in, and so forth. And in 2022, one team claimed that they had developed a perovskite solar panel that can last for 30 years. But I guess we won't know for sure for about 30 years. But one of the most promising ideas in research is to create tandem solar panels that can combine the strengths of both perovskite and silicon. In fact, this crystalline partnership seems to produce a more efficient panel than you would get from either perovskite or silicon on its own. So while one perovskite gets to stand up on a podium and hold a little trophy for being the most common substance in the world, another might hold the key to taking better care of it.